Happy Father's Day once again. And the reason I was playing that song is, if you come to this church as a dad, chances are you're probably doing better than you used to be doing as a dad, or you're growing and you're making some difference. Hopefully you're doing pretty good. So I commend you as dads. If you come to this church, it'd be tough to be too squirrely and still be here. But I was looking for a Father's Day card for my own dad, and he left when we were, I think I was 11 or 12, and he never really put much into me. And then our relationship, if you remember that song, the dad is sad because his kid grew up and treats him the way that he treated the kid when he was younger. And that was that the dad was too busy to take much time with the boy, and the boy kept saying, "Well, when I grow up, I'm gonna be like you, Dad." How many know all your sons, they're looking at you, and no matter how kind or what kind of dad you are, that's their image of what they're gonna grow up to be. Good or bad, that's what they get. And there's just something in them that they're gonna imitate you. And to this day, my wife, my dad taught me three things. He taught me how to say linoleum, and he taught me how to yell in the car at other drivers. And I've retained that. I can still say linoleum, and I've retained the other one very well, the yelling at cars. And it's kind of hard to deal with some days for other people, but. But the point I'm making, guys, is that you and I, we need to be really aware that whatever we demonstrate to our kids, that is what, whether we try to do it or not, that's what they're going to pick up, and that's what they're going to deal with. And I was looking for a Father's Day card. Have you ever looked for a Father's Day card? The guys that they must be sending those cards to must really be something, because I couldn't find any that fit my dad. I love my dad, but he never really put much into my life. And I'm not being either, because his dad died when he was 16. So he didn't know what to do. But, irrelevant that, I just picked up what he didn't know how to do. And then I have that same relationship with him that he had. He was too busy for me when I was a kid, and I'm too busy for him now that I'm an adult. You follow that? And it's funny how we that progression just keeps going until we make a decision to recognize that and do something about it. Are you following me? And one thing that just really amazes me about our life is that all of us want to be loved. Amen? How many of you know that? All of us want, the guys want to be loved. The guys want a dad. Amen? And so as part of my love for you, we got some tickets here today. And so I'm going to just do this randomly. No, get out of here. Now, let me just say, oh, okay, with some more contestants, that's good. So, as a guy, I went out and bought some stuff for guys for Father's Day. I forgot and left it in the office, and the women wrapped it. I'm like, guys don't want something wrapped. You got to unwrap. They just want you to throw it to them, look at it, go away with it. It's like, what are you? We're not women. We're guys. How many of you guys know what I'm talking about? I mean, it's like, who wants to get a wrapped present? Just throw me the thing and let's go. So, but thank you, whoever wrapped them. Number 22-55-26, are you in the house? 5526, in the house. 5526, put that away. Is that you? All right. That's for you. God bless you. Stay thin. See, now that's a man gift. Men don't want a tie and perfume. They want cookies. Right? Am I right? Come on, Adam's down there. He's glowing. He's like, yeah, finally a good man gift. All right. 5516. 5516. Come on, Juan. Okay, now Juan. They were demonstrating these in Costco the other day. Come on, this is a man stuff. These things were so good, Juan, that I had to get some for you. There you go. Amen. Hallelujah. So anyway, that song is talking about how the son just, he looked at his dad, he says, I'm going to be like you. And then the dad found out later that everything he taught his dad was only hurting him, or everything he taught his son. Amen. And so I want to read, I've got a couple things I want to read. This is called, I love this story. You've probably heard it if you've been around here for very long. But it's called In Search of Paco. And it says, there's a Spanish story of a father and a son who had become estranged. The son ran away, and the father set off to find him. He searched for months, but no avail. Finally, in a last desperate effort to find him, the father put an ad in the Madrid newspaper. The ad read, Dear Paco, meet me in front of this newspaper office at noon on Saturday. All is forgiven. I love you. Your father. On Saturday, 800 Pacos showed up looking for forgiveness and love from their fathers. I'm going to tell you that I absolutely believe, I thank God for the mothers, I thank God for the great job they do and the influence they are, but I'm going to tell you what the world needs is fathers. And I'm not trying to be crude, but they don't need sperm donors, they need dads, they need fathers, they need men on the job. Are you out there? There was a football player, an NFL football player, who, when he retired, Bill Glass, does that sound like a football player? No, he's an older guy. You guys probably don't know him. But when he retired, he went to the ministry, and he went through 350-some prisons throughout the country, our country. And he did thousands and thousands of one-on-one interviews with male prison inmates. And he said, out of thousands and thousands of one-on-one interviews with male inmates, he said 100% of them hated their fathers. And that their violence that they committed was how they demonstrated that hate for their fathers. That's sad. That's sad. Dads, if you don't think you have an influence, if you don't think you can make a difference, you better think again. Because there's one thing lacking in this world, and it's the presence of a father in the family. You guys are probably doing good. I hope you're doing good. If you're like me, I did crummy for the first 5 years. My oldest son didn't get the benefit of how wonderful I am. My daughter got the most benefit, and look how she's doing. And my wife and I were just talking this morning how my oldest son, she says, he's a lot like you were before you got saved and began to change. Because there's just something that the kids watch you, and they're not conscious of it, but they pick it up. And unless they make a decision to get born again and receive Christ and do something with their life, they're going to imitate exactly what we are. And if you're not there, they won't be there. If you're angry, they'll be angry. If you don't know how to show love, they won't either. And they won't pick it up just on their own. How many understand what I'm saying? Amen. Is this too sober a time to pass out another ticket? I don't want you to get sober. I don't want you to get too down on me. 5497. 5497. Oh, look at my happy brother back there. Okay, brother, come on up and get this. You got to come and get it. I am bringing it to you. Now, brother, I have no idea what's in here because they wrapped it. And you don't have to open it up here either, brother. You can take it home. Now, you do need to take a picture of it and put it on Facebook. Okay. Along with whatever you have for lunch. Okay. Amen. Okay, let's do one more. I like giving stuff away, don't you? 5537. 5537. Come on, Andre. There you go, my brother. I'm going to let you have that ticket, too. You can keep that. Happy Father's Day, brother. Love you. You're a fine young man. I don't care what your wife says. Amen. But how many know this fatherhood thing? You know, if you're like me, I screwed up as a dad when I first started. I wasn't any good at it. I wasn't any good at being married. But you know what? If you're having difficulty with it, God will help you. God will help straighten you out. He'll help straighten out your thinking. And hopefully you're not done learning yet. Because I don't know about you, I'm still praying, God, help me be a good father. God, help me be a good pastor. I mean, this morning, I'm like, dear God, help me make sure I'm doing what I need to be doing for this church, for the people here. Because I don't want to turn out people that are following me if I'm going wrong. I don't want my kids to be going wrong if I'm teaching them wrong. Are you out there? Man, the same guy that did the prison thing, I believe it was Alabama, they said they had 7,500 male prisoners. He said, and the odd thing about it is out of 7,500 male prisoners, there were 7 Jewish prisoners. Out of 7,500, there were 7 Jews. And he was really, and the guy that was over the prisons was really astonished at that. But when you think about it, the Jewish father, from the day that the child is born, is always saying, bless you, I love you, God's blessings be with you. And what I'm saying is, your kids, guys, your kids need to hear from you that you love them. They need to hear God bless you. They need to hear good things come out of your mouth. And I know as a man, as a dad, sometimes we can spout off before we think, but you and I have to pay attention. We have to think before we speak, and when we speak, it's got to be lifting that kid up first, because that's good. The most amazing thing that I've ever heard is that between the ages of 2 and 7, a child is formed. How they're going to react to situations, how they're going to think about things, their attitudes, they're all formed in those early years. And what I've watched over 30-some years of doing this and 60-some years of being alive, is I watch people who are formed in the formative years and spend the whole rest of their life trying to get over it and get fixed from it. What a blessing it would be if our kids would find out when they're young that they're valuable and precious. You as a dad, you may not even know that yet, but I'm going to tell you what, if you learn how to become a good son to the Father, He'll help you become a good dad. And He'll restore you from all that junk too. Amen? Amen? Don't get too sober. Let's do another giveaway. I like this. This is fun. 55. Anybody yet? 11. 5511. All right. Come on, Josh. Happy Father's Day. You can keep that ticket. No, you can have it. Let's do one more. Five, five, one, 13. Who came in just after he did? 5513. All right, David. This came amazingly at Costco. This came 2 in one pack. Who'd have thought that Costco would have 2 at one pack? All right, who's a dad? Okay, Juan, get ready. Who else is a dad? Are you a dad? Whoa! Okay, Mox, this has nothing to do with golf. This should go straight. Oh boy, under the banister. I'm gonna go short first. Just so I don't kill anybody. Okay, you ready, young man? Michael, duck. Whoa! That's her first time, too. Wow, and I almost hit her. It's hard to gauge with that beam up there. You know, when I was an all-star little league pitcher when I was a kid. And that was only 62 years ago. I just want to see if your wife could catch. Wait, you're going for doubles. You? Did I hit her? Oh, man. Now, if you can't catch him, that's not my problem. Who else? Ye gads, I missed all you guys? Okay. This isn't golf, Mox. This should go straight. Mox and I played golf. We got to play again because we need to practice. Whoa. Did you get one, Gene? Yeah, you're easy. Okay, Jimmy, come on. You didn't know church was going to be. You should be prayed up when you come to church. There's no telling what you could get hit with. Did you get one? How many are you going to take? Anybody else? Oh, come on. Come on. Did he not get one yet? Oh, Michael. I thought they were pointing at Vinny, so he's got seven of them. Who? Kevin? Is he a daddy? Juan? Are your kids eating yours, Juan? Nate, you get one. You got two of the best kids I know. All right, brother. Are you ready? No flinching. Samson, did you get one? You don't get one. You're like a girl. All right. Hallelujah. How can you beat that at church? Amen. So my point is that we as fathers, what I want you to understand is being a father is an important job. And we need to take it seriously because there's a lot of people counting on us. You know, I believe that, you know, the biggest problem in our country, in fact, the world, is the fatherless family. And for you single moms that are doing things by yourself, God bless you, man, what a job. But for us that are still dads, you know, we need to make sure we're doing a good job. Amen. And so, in honor of Father's Day, I have 463 points on things you can do to be a good dad. It'll help you. Anybody not get one? Who is that?
I have two children.
So, Let me say this. There's no substitute for time spent with your kids. Okay? There's no such thing as, well, we're having quality time. Quality time does not equate to all time. Your kids need your time. My wife was asking me, because I did pitch when I was a little league. That was like 60 years ago, almost. And she says, well, did your dad play catch with you? And no, he didn't. I nailed a bucket up on a tree, and I played with a bucket, pitched into a bucket. My mom went to my games, but my dad never went to a game. I don't know if he ever saw a game. And we were up in Kennewick and we were all-star team. I was all-star pitcher, and my dad never even came. He's never even come to my church. 30-some years of pastoring, he's never come. And I'm not dissing on him. I'm just saying it has an impact on me, and whatever happened to him had an impact on him. And it's not about finding blame. It's about us recognizing where we picked up bad habits and then doing something with them. You know, it's not about finding blame. You know, I don't care how bad your parents might have been. Just forgive them and move on. Okay? It's not about, well, my parents screwed me up. Well, you're with Jesus now. Get unscrewed. Amen? And so let me just share a few things with you that I think as a dad are important to your kids. And number one, of course, is there's no substitute for time you spent with your kids. You know, just, and I don't care what kind of a dad you are, how you are, spend time with your kids, because you're especially your sons, they're going to want to be like you. I don't care if you come home and you're all covered in dirt and dust, when you know, your son's going to want to go out and get covered with dust to be like you, because you're his father, and you're the one he wants to be like. So, number one would be read to your children. As a dad, read to your children. Because a child doesn't, they don't learn how to love reading, especially nowadays, without somebody reading to them. If they don't learn how to read, how are they going to love reading the Bible? Amen. And as a dad, I'm going to tell you what, I believe that the most important thing you can do for your kids is teach them how to love the Word of God. Amen. I love my grandbabies. They'll come in, and we keep them every once in a while when the kids have a date night. And Sydney will wake up, and Kinsey will wake up, and we'll get them up, and we've got the little kid Bible, and then they like plop in bed with you, and they like bring their Bible because their dad's doing a good job teaching them how to read the Bible, and that's cool. Amen. So number one, read to your kids. How can these have names on the back of them? Oh, well, that's Mark Belisa. He gets one. Two two five five two eight. Oh, look at you. Happy Father's Day.
Thank you very much.
Glad you're here. I don't know what that is, but hopefully you can use it. Amen. 5525. Oh, is that you? Well, there you go, Sonny. Here, you can keep that too. Happy Father's Day. Well, let's do one more. 5501. Oh, come on, brother. Happy Father's Day. This young man's a banjo player.
Yes.
Right? Banjo. Yep. Kind of like on Deliverance. Right? Only better. Yeah, you get that a lot. Imagine that. 5517, but he's a fine young man, got a great family. 5517. Mr. Eric Foote is the proud daughter of Liv, or proud father of Liv. He's the daughter of Liv. Wow. That was a fupa. Number two, dads. How many of you want to raise some good kids? You know, I don't know about you. I don't want to raise idiots. And I don't want to raise idiots because I am one. Are you out there? Because if you are one, that's what you're going to raise. So I don't want to be an idiot, and I don't want to raise idiots. I want to raise some good kids. I want to raise some kids that when they shake hands with you, they can look you in the eye. Come on. And they don't give you all this squirrely stuff, but they've got confidence because you put it in them. Can I just tell you something? Your kids don't learn morality at school. They don't get a moral compass at school. They don't learn self-confidence at school. They get it from you, Dad. Their life is in your hands. And whatever they come out, that's good, Riley, keep it up. Because whatever they come out, Dads, we made them that way. And you can't say, well, they were just, hey, they had ADD, TTT. No, they didn't. That stuff's a bunch of bunk. You get God involved and fix all that. Yeah. Number two, dads, turn off the television. Teach your children to be sparingly and be wise in their entertainment. Teach them how to put life in proper perspective and that TV is not real life. And don't train your kids whenever you don't want to deal with them to put them in front of the TV. You deal with them. You teach them. You train them. How many know parenting is a 24-hour-a-day job? Not a 30-minute-a-day job or when you feel like it or go play. Are you out there? This is one of my favorites. Teach your children to be grateful. Amen. Teach them to be. Don't deliver them from that entitlement mentality. Are you out there? We have a thing we've done with our kids ever since they were babies, and Christmas takes us like 7 hours. Birthdays take a long time, but I'm telling you, teaching your children gratitude is worth it. Whenever our kids, whenever we, at Christmas or birthdays, whenever you open a present, you don't just shuffle the paper over and then grab the next one. You go to whoever gave you that gift, and you give them a hug, you tell them thank you, and you mean it. And then you go back and get the next one, and it's not just a mad dash of throwing paper all over the place and opening presents as fast as you can. It's gratefulness and appreciation. Somebody took time to buy you that gift. And you owe them the respect to be thankful and grateful. And your kids need to be taught that. Are you out there? While I'm on that, teach your kids when they go potty, after they wash their hands and there's water all over the faucet and the mirror and everything, teach them to take a paper towel and wipe down that faucet so that the next person doesn't have to come in and touch their water. I'm a grown man. I do that wherever I go. It's just like, why would you leave that mess for somebody else? Teach your kids how to be grateful about what they've gotten and be nice and neat. Amen? Somebody's going to need a gift after that one. That was tough. 5507. Y'all okay? 5507. Uh-oh. I kept two things back. They didn't get wrapped. You don't have to mess with the wrapping paper. Amen. Not that it wasn't nice that the ladies did that for us. We're thankful. We just could have saved them some money. So teach your children to be grateful. Teach them not to be whiners. I don't know about you, but when I go through a store or something and I see some kid is screaming at his mom, I want this, I want this, I want this. I know Daddy should have been somewhere teaching that child how to act in the store. Are you out there? These may not be your rules now, but they should be. Teach them to say thank you. Please and thank you. Teach your children to be polite. Daddies do it. Amen. Moms have got enough on their plate. Well, I had to work all day. Yeah, but you got kids that are going to grow up. What are they going to be like? Amen. And teach them that money is earned, not just handed out. You know, I believe that as you, for kids, you know, if they're a part of the family, they should do chores. They should be part of their family. But there should be some things where they earn an allowance. And then you teach them how to handle the money. Right? Teach your children to be generous and involve your children in giving. And I'm going to tell you this. Teach your children from the time they're small to tithe on everything they get. Teach them to put 10% in savings from the time that they're small. And then teach them to put 10% in investments. And teach them to live on 70% instead of 150%. Are you out there? How many of you had been better off if you'd learned how to handle money before you ever got any? I mean, my goodness, you know, if we will train our kids how to tithe, how to save money, and how to invest money, they'll take better care of us when we get older. That's my thinking. No, but they'll be able to take better care of themselves, won't they? Amen. Consider your reason for living both to glorify God and to pass on to your children an inheritance of bold, deep faith. Guys, don't leave it up to your wife to teach your children how to be Christians. As the man of the house, I can tell you that most churches are full of, they're not full of kids who think only women go to church. Most boys think, well, church is for girls, and church is for men. We got plenty of men. But make sure you're passing that on to your kids. We don't want to have a whole church full of morally good kids but unsaved. Amen. And so, you know, as the husband, make sure that you're not, you know, living one way at church and another way at home. You know, can I just tell you something, guys? Don't go home and cuss at your kids and cuss at your wife. Cussing should be done. You shouldn't be that stupid anymore. Okay, you need something. All right. 5535. Who's that? 5535. Whoa, Lenny. Lenny. Happy Father's Day.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. So, look, Psalm 71:18 says this. It says, so even to old age and gray hairs, O God, do not forsake me until I proclaim your might to another generation, your power to all those who come. Amen. Guys, how many of you know we're being entrusted? You know, I don't know about you, but we've had the church. This January will be our 25th year with this church. We started it back in January of 1990. And, man, I mean, one day I'm sure that I'm going to get old. Won't be for a long time yet, but one day it could happen. And I want to prepare the next generation to do this church. Amen. But we can't wait until I'm 90 to train them. We've got to train them now so that they're ready to handle all this stuff and do whatever else God's got for them. Amen. So don't put off training your kids in the ways of the Lord and the things of God. You know, well, they'll just pick it up when they get to be 18. No, they won't. Listen, all these kids that just graduated, Can I just tell you something? Playtime's over. Now the work starts. You did. If I can just be honest, you didn't learn anything in high school about living life. High school was a big deception and a waste of time for most people. I'm serious. It's like wasted 12 years. Not this group, but most high school kids can't even read at second grade level. It's up to us, parents, to train our children. Dads, it's up to you. The Bible says, fathers, you train up your children. It doesn't say, mama, train them up. It says, fathers, you train them up. You teach them. And if I would, I'm not going to do it, but if I were to take a poll here on how many of you, if you were in prison, would be there because you hated your dad, there'd probably be a lot of hands that go up. Or if I was to take a poll of how many of you have a dad that really never was a dad, there'd probably be a lot of us. And my thing is, let's not do to the next generation what happened to us. Amen. Let's make a difference in this generation. Dads, let's not just have Father's Day, let's have Family Day. Let's have Kids Day. Let's have a family that's, you know, Rebecca and I, one of the things, you know, when our kids were young, other couples with kids, they'd come around and they'd say, well, let's get a babysitter and let's all go to the beach. And our attitude just had to be God, and I don't know what, but our attitude was, heck with you. If we're going to the beach, we're taking the kids. Right. But see, a lot of parents, their idea is, how can we get rid of the kids and have fun? Your kids are fun. Unless you trained them wrong. I just hate being around my kids. Well, that's because you trained them that way. Just a thought. Okay, we better do one more. Oh, Lord, let it be the right one. 5-5-2. 5-5-2-0. Mox! Mox, you noticed I'm taking these out. But I'll tell you what, I'll leave you one. That's for Angie, because you already got one.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Happy Father's Day, brother. Amen. 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 I was a pitcher, not a catcher. Okay, watch out. Hallelujah. Amen. So, for dads, fear God so that your children may be blessed. Psalm 112:1 says this, blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who greatly delights in his commandments. His offspring will be mighty in the land. His offspring is kids. How many of you want your kids to be mighty in the land? Amen. I want my kids. I want my son that's in China to come back to God. He's a good kid. Unfortunately, he's just imitating what I trained him to do the first 10 years of his life, 7 years of his life. Amen. He said, so delight in his commandments, his offspring will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Amen. Hallelujah. The next one, write this down. Guys, this is for the men only. Pray for your children. Come on, men, you pray for your children. Don't leave that up to your wife. You pray for them. Can I just be honest with you guys? In the family of God arena, you have more spiritual authority than your wife does. Use it. Don't waste it. Don't put it off on her. You stand up and be the man, and you do the praying, you do the leading. And I'm not trying to make you feel bad. I'm just saying, if you want to have a great family, you do your job and you'll have a great family. Amen. You do what you, and it's and I know for some of us it's hard because we weren't trained that way. And if I can be honest with you, there's just when I was going through this, it wasn't that I was stupid. There were just some things I didn't know. I didn't know how some things worked. I just didn't know. I was just stupid. I was a kid. I was an idiot. Just like you. But you learn those things, and you begin to change, and man, your family just changes. And then you get you a great family, and all the people are like, wow, you got good kids. In our pastor circles, you know, we're not one of the largest churches, but we are the envy of most all of our pastor friends, out of many of them. You know why? It's not because of the church size. It's not because I'm so good looking or my wife is so good looking, although she is. It's because our children are with us in the ministry. You'd be surprised how many of our pastor friends with larger churches lost their kids because they put the ministry first. Don't you lose your kids because you put the job first or making money first. You put the family first. You put your kids first. You put your wife first. You put God first. And everything else will work out. Amen? Amen? All I'm here is to try and help. I want to help you have the best life God has available for you. And the only way you can do it is by taking His advice found in here and applying it to your life. Amen. Stand up with me, praise God. We're all done with the gifts. It's time to go home. Hallelujah. Is there more? Amen. Hallelujah. What I want you to, all your dads, if you're a dad, if you're a father, would you raise your hand? And I want anybody who's around them, just put your hand on them. Put your hand on those guys that have their hands up. I'm going to tell you what, I believe that being a dad is one of the most difficult jobs in the world. It demands a lot and the stakes are high. You hear me? The stakes are real high. And Father, my heart just goes out to all the dads in this place. Put your hand on them. Father, I thank you for all these men. They're in church. They're doing the best they can. And Father, I just undergird them right now with faith and love. I thank you for the efforts that they're making. And I ask you, Father, to give them wisdom. Open the eyes of their understanding, Father, not just to point out their flaws, but to encourage them. To build them up, to let them see that what they're doing is not meaningless, it's not fruitless, but it's the will of God. Help them to see the importance of the job, the calling of being a father. That there's a difference between just having kids and being the dad. And Father, I just thank you that in this church we have strong fathers, we have strong, healthy families, but we have men who take their place in authority under you and exercise that spiritual authority in the family and in this planet. And Father, I just bless them. I thank you, Father, that they are strong and healthy. I thank you that they are wise in the dealings with finances. I thank you, Father, that they have the job they need, the job they're called to. I thank you, Father, that they have the support in their family that they need. And, Father, the support from this church. But, Father, I thank you that they know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you're on their side. You're not counting up against them their faults. But you're there to help them. You're on the inside of them to help them, to bless them, to strengthen them, and to lead them. And Lord, I just bless you for them. I thank you so much for these mighty men of God. Thank you, Father, for those that have heard you and obeyed and come. And that they'll be strong in the things of God all the days of life and train up strong, healthy children, strong, healthy families. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.